his pastor's love there. Says only marriage is a mosaic. You build with your spouse through millions of tiny moments that create your love story. Isn't that beautiful? I didn't write that, but I sure can appreciate it. In Israel, they have dug up so many tales, which is what they call a dig, and the mosaic will be on the floor, and they won't be any larger than this. Some of them smaller than that, and the entire floor will be covered with a picture that they use those size tiles to make. Of course, you're talking about a land with no TV, no internet, none of the distractions of the day, and I'm sure working on a major project like that was quite fulfilling. But a mosaic, we spend our lifetime. Roger and I, this month, will have finished 54 years working on our mosaic. Millions of moments. Wonderful, isn't it? It's easier to build up a child than to repair an adult.
So true.
Your words and actions have power in your child's life. Use them wisely. And I would advise you to think of your home always as under construction. In the name of Jesus. How many of you today have something on your heart or in your mind where your family is under construction? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we come knowing that you know we're a people under construction. We're a marriage, those of us that are married. We're in a marriage under construction. But those of us who have families, and even down through the generations, there's always something under construction. Very seldom in our life do we walk through our family life and not see the yellow construction tape run around the site that says, you know, here's where something's being done, or here's where something's being repaired. There's a leak in this person's life. We're always coming to you with a family that says, Lord, our family's under construction. And without your help, it's not going to be right. Help us as we follow this love dare through the week. Help each person to read it and to see what we have to do just to show our love to those around us. Help us be the main person on the side. To see that the construction in our families end up as a Christian home. In this we pray, Lord, in your name. Amen. Thank you.
try different things and the sound. And, I think I have a little bit of a ring that I need to take care of. We'll deal with that later. Had some announcements given to me this morning. Will my album is having a yard sale this coming Saturday, the 22nd, 8 to 3. And it's Dunes tools and garage equipment, and woodworking tools, things like that. And it's a 300 Classic Drive. And most of you know where it is. If you don't, see Boone, she'll tell you how to get there. And I'll take care of that. And also, it was mentioned this morning that August the 21st is Senior Citizens Day, and Pepper brought that one up. So, for you that are senior citizens, next Friday is your day.
If we remember.
If you remember. I have not
remembered. Pick all those senior moments.
I haven't got there in age, but in memory, yeah, I'm picking there. Next Sunday, the 23rd at 2 p.m., the pastor wants to meet in the fellowship hall for those that plan to do youth work. And if you're interested in leading or just helping, assisting in that program, you can come next Sunday at 2 p.m. And she'll be glad to have all the help that she can get. This evening, she's going to be doing some introduction of our evangelist and prayer team. And I would hope that everybody be there. We have a great core group, because our core group can't do it alone. We need all of you to come and be a part of this and just help us and just grow the church and do some wonderful things for the Lord. Also, I think Eric said this is the last we can do this. The Rural King receipts, if you have any that you have put in, she'll bring them to her, she'll try to get those put in. I think it may be a little bit past time, but we'll try that anyway.
We've got to the 1st of September to get them put in, but you had them already spent.
Okay. So you shouldn't. The spending would have already happened
yesterday.
And you can still enter those receipts up to September 1st. So that'll go with that. I want to thank all those that came and worked so very hard and diligently in the yard sale. Another great, great success. I tell you, there's been people who've come and worked and done things, and we're so appreciative of that. We'll have our concert next Sunday, the 23rd, to Satisfy, and looking forward to that, and just come and just join together and enjoy each other's company. And you can read the other announcements that's in the bulletin at your leisure. And if there's anything I missed, I'm sure somebody will let me know. But there's a lot going on. And if you want to be part of anything, just come see any of the board members, the pastor, and we'll see that you have something to do.
Oh,
Savior for the ones who said God has been good. God's still answering prayer. He's still on the throne. We have those, like I said, still continue to struggle with different ailments, cancer, like Barb's sister that we've been praying for so long. God is good.
Cherish, and that others have learned to cherish.
It's a glorious thing that you did when you gave us the Sabbath. You gave us 52 days a year. Officially in your word that you said, I will set things apart for you. You can stop at the end of six. You can stop and you can officially take a day to let your bodies rest, to worship maybe, to enjoy being in my house, to enjoy time with the family. I officially give you as a human 52 days right off the top of the calendar. I want you to take time to love me and time to love each other. We thank you for that, Lord. We think of all the generations that we've assembled around the table with, both spiritually and physically, on the Sabbath. Thank you for that privilege, and thank you for making it part. You could have said, I want you to drive the 365 and add the fourth on. But you didn't. You said, I give you a day. Stop. Love me. Love each other. It heals more than the body. It heals the mind and the soul. And we thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
This morning, I woke up dream, after a dream, I was dreaming that someone was going to attack me. But then a cop showed up just at the right time. And the Lord told me that's exactly how he is. When the devil comes to attack us, he's right there. He's got our back. And I'm so thankful that the Lord has my back and that I can go to him in times of trouble. And I just ask for your prayers for our family, for her health as well as other needs. I just praise you this morning.
I'm not complaining, for I'm sure. this wonderful singing that we have here, it occurred to me when I was sitting up there that if you ever want to hear me sing like that, you should probably come to heaven. That's the only hope I have for that. When music was passed out, I must have been climbing a tree or doing something that I did at those ages, or when that was happening. Today I have something on my mind that I hope will eventually affect every one of us. And partly, I understand that we're in a pandemic. But if I hear that many more times, I think that I'm going to be an elder sitting in a pile screaming. I think I had about all of that I could swallow. Even though I know it's a reality, and even though Wilma, you're the pastor, you should have a better attitude. I understand all that. But I've held back on trying to move the kingdom forward just about as long as I can. And I understand that there's a mighty enemy out there and that it is fighting us going anywhere, anyway. But I am on my watch and I will answer to the Lord what I've been on my watch. And I can't just sit and pretend there's nothing to be done in the kingdom because I hear so many messages telling me it's impossible. So therefore, got my plow out, scrubbed off what I could, asked the Lord to anoint it, and asked for one for everybody else that would join me, and I think it's time to plow some fields.
Amen.
Now if we don't get to so many crops, if we don't get any harvest, it won't be because we didn't try. So there we go. So in thinking about two things, one you've already heard, to try to establish some kind of a youth work. So we're thinking about meeting next Sunday at 2, as you've heard now for the third time. That if you wish to be a part of that in any way, to let us know or come. I understand a lot of the barriers that are against that. And I look around and I understand that there's not many children being trained in this last 6 months. Again, I still know it's my watch. I must try something. So therefore, I want to do that. Another thing I want to do is I want to make it possible for every one of us and you out there, if you choose to be a part of an evangelistic prayer team. We can pray no matter where people are and no matter the conditions. We can unite as an evangelistic prayer team. And I want to introduce that more tonight. My co-brook, our general superintendent, and the church extension, and a select group of people that have been working on this, have put together just some simple how to try to win a soul techniques. I've looked them over. I've dove into them totally and swam around in them for weeks. And I've come up out of that study believing there's good stuff there. Good stuff that every one of us can use. But I thought today we should take a look at the sinner. And once I started reading about the sinner, man, did I ever get, the Lord just really, he almost took my mind and did what the girls do with this slime. Have you ever seen children with that slime? And they get it and they just, and then sometimes while that one's going that way, there's other little hands going this way. And then it all pops and and then they start all over again, put it all back together. I feel like that's kind of how my mind has been thinking about the sinner. And I began thinking about a sinner I knew very well. And I made some notes about that sinner to share with you. And I can tell you that this sinner person, I talked to him, I asked them. And they said they, before they met Christ, they didn't think it was possible to be saved. And I asked them why. They said because in their childhood, they had seen some people who they later learned were not genuine Christians doing a lot of things that they made fun of. And so the devil said, you've sinned against the Holy Ghost and you'll never be saved. And so this person said for years they had the feeling they could never be saved. And then they had the fear of hell. The fear of hell was so real. But yet there was faults inside this person that they couldn't control. They just couldn't control. No matter how hard they tried, so they thought I could never be a Christian. However, I want to tell you that person was me. And on Mother's Day, 1975, I found that all of that was the devil's lies. When I finally gave myself to the Lord, everything has been different since that day. It was all just a trick of the devil. And I believed that, and I lived that for many years, thinking that I watched people come and give their hearts to the Lord, and I think I can never do that, because somehow I have no value. Somehow I have no worth to the kingdom. And you may think that's strange, but it was my reality. And as you look at sinner people, you hear a lot of different things. I wrote some of the things down I've heard at the end of years. I'm living a dark life. And truly, some of these people that have told me that, I would have to tell you, I don't know how they're alive. They've been in that dark of places that I don't know how they survived it. And many of their friends that were with them did not survive. I've had people say, I'm under condemnation. The Lord has condemned me over something, and I'm just not willing to give it up. I had a person tell me, now I'm going to change the fact, but I'll tell you, I'll make up something to tell you without revealing the version. Let's say a person said to me, I'm condemned because I play too many games on my iPad. But I'd rather go to hell than give up the games on my iPad. I had a grown person, that person now is either in their 70s or 80s, and that was probably, I told you it was a made up event, but they gave me an actual life event. That was probably 30 to 40 years ago, and they are still unsaved. And the last time I seen them, they were still doing the thing they felt they wouldn't give up. Some people will say, I feel dirty because of all the things I've done. I don't think the church will accept me. Other people say, I feel defeated. I just feel defeated. I feel like it's just futile to try to be a Christian because I'm just not laying out the right stuff. And I'm Adam Sain. I knew in Roger, you're made out of the right stuff. But we're not made out of the right stuff. But they didn't know Roger and Wilma when Roger and Wilma were sinners. They only knew Roger and Wilma after many years of walking with the Lord. You know, it's easy for a little sapling that's being blown about by everything that moves and anything that crawls on it, bends it, and twists it, or in all the seasons, to look at a pine tree and say, well, look out, how easy the pine tree is. But then pine tree had to grow too, didn't it? I've had people say, I'm too broken. There's too many pieces that I can't bring. I've got too many pieces in my life that will never be fixed. And I always remind them, stained glass windows are made of broken pieces. Some will say to me, there are dark, hidden, dirty things in my life that I don't want to tell Jesus about. I don't want to tell anybody about. Some will say, I have weights. If I don't do what my wife wants me to do, I'll lose my wife. So I do what my wife wants. I've had people tell me. I've had officers of churches tell me I have to quit being an officer because of that. I've had preachers tell me I have to quit preaching because my wife doesn't want me to. I've had women tell me my husband does not want me to get involved in the church. He doesn't care if I go occasionally, but if I keep my husband, I cannot become involved with Christ. I have heard just about anything you can think of. But as I prayed, the Lord showed me something today that I think we all need to take a look at. I have been shown something, and all those things are true, and this whole idea of sin and how it manifests itself is as different as every human on the face of the earth. Every one of us have lived through different circumstances. We've been taught different amounts of the Bible. We've been taught different false things. And we have different reasons of why we do what we do. And some of us like doing things we should be doing, and some of us resist it very much, doing what we should do. So sin is as different, I think, after my reading, I think it's as different as every one of us. At the same time, I think there is a common thread in it that I had never picked up before, even though it's aggravated me to the point of aggravating the fire out of me. You know what I mean by aggravating the fire out of you? That you just heard it and heard it and heard it until something goes inside you, and you're about ready to go, sit down and shut up, I'm going to tell you a few things. Yeah, you've all been there. I see you people know about aggravating the fire out of you. I have sat and talked to people. As a matter of fact, some of my parishioners saw me leave that situation the other day rather than face it again. And they caught it, and they mentioned it to me later. I have heard people, and through my years, I have wasted many, 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 many hours conversing with people who wanted to argue with me about parts of this Bible. Now, the reason they wanted to argue is because they didn't want to go by it. Now, that could be something as tiny as this, or it could be something that would shoot right out the roof and be a curve still rising out there. You know, it's like I picked a mountain, and I'm going to defend that mountain, whether that mountain is really a mountain in the Bible or not. There are a tremendous number of people who want to tell you they do not have to be a part of a church. And they want to spend their time arguing with you that I do not have to be a part of a church. Yet my Bible tells me to not neglect assembling yourselves together, even more as the day approaches. And as long as I live, I'm expecting that to be in here. So that's where I take faith. Now, at the same time, I'm thinking of this book saying that we're all members. members of the body. And I am soon to be a senior citizen. Some of you might think I am now. But as a senior citizen possibly coming up, I can tell you, having traveled even worldwide in some instances, I have never met an eye by itself. Have any of you met an eye just going around? You know, just walking around all of a sudden, you say, oh, well, I, whose eye are you? Well, I'm so-and-so's eye. Well, this is Wilma, my whole body. And I have never met an arm. I mean, I've just been all over the place, and I just never met an arm all of a sudden, and an arm reaches out and shakes hands. Well, hello, Pastor. How are you? Well, hi, how are you? I see you're an arm. Yes, I'm an arm. For those two reasons, I think you have to be a part of the church.
Amen.
Okay, thank you. I think you have to be a part of the church because I've never seen a member alive without a body. And you said it was simple. But let me tell you, that is a little sample, and I can give you more, but that's a little sample of what's called, are you ready for this? Stay with me because this is very interesting. It's a sample of what it means to be a sinner. What it means to be a sinner is that book, just the way it is, tells me that if I don't believe in Jesus Christ with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and submit myself to Jesus Christ, ask the devil to leave, and ask the Lord Jesus Christ to move in, listen to the Holy Spirit, and to be a person in, I have my being in Christ Jesus. I am a Christian, and I am anxious to please the Lord. Anything other than that has to have an argument. And when I start arguing against it, I'm a sinner. I'm saying, there's the word of God, but I don't take it. I'm not taking that. Well, it says, I'll just name something. It says in here that I'm to do unto you as I would have you do unto me. And I say, well, I say, do unto them before they get to do it to you. How many heard that? Mm-hmm. So, am I saying what the Lord said about do unto others as I would have them do unto me? What have I done with the teaching of the Lord? I have said, pitch that. Let me tell you how to do it. You do unto them before they get the chance to do it to you. Well, that just teach you. Wrong. Listen, you will be shocked unless you're very, very different from me, and a lot of you are so intelligent and so wonderful that you probably already know this, but I think of people that I sat down, and I don't want to say enough to ever reveal anybody, but I can think of people who wanted to sit with me and to talk about something that bothered me about the Bible. And I spent 1,000 hours on that. And when I get done, I'll guarantee you they couldn't have told you one scripture I told them. All they wanted to do, you ready for this? They wanted to convince me they didn't have to go by this book in order to be a Christian. Now this is not uncommon. And as I searched the scriptures, I was shocked. And I'm a Bible reader, as you know, but I was shocked that one of the main things about being a sinner is that you let your thinking become stinking thinking. And when you have stinking thinking, you become a sinner.
Right with the devil.
Stinking thinking. we're going to kind of visit there by story. In Mark the fifth chapter, there's several good stories. But if you remember that Jairus, the ruler, has a little daughter at home that's about to die, and he comes to Jesus. And when he comes to Jesus, he wants Jesus to go with him to heal his daughter. And Jesus says, yes, I will with you. And Jesus turns to go with him. And at that moment, the lady that had the issue of blood has come to be healed. And all of a sudden, she's made her way through the crowd. And she, at that moment, as Jesus starts, she grabs the hem of his garment. And she didn't just touch his garment. She touched his power. She believed in him. And she trusted him. And the power came out of Jesus. He said, virtue. Virtue went out of Jesus. And she was healed. And so he said, well, who touched me? And they all go, look at this girl, Lord. Who can tell who touched you? And he said, no, somebody touched me. And she said, it was me, Lord. And so all this delay, healing the woman with the issue of blood, allows time for the girl to die. So here come the messengers from Jairus' house. And they run up to him and say, don't bother the master. There's no need to bother the master. She's gone. In other words, come on, let's go home and have a funeral. Your daughter's dead. And scripture, now listen to what was going on. And listen to the sin in this. While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain, which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? First of all, if you just had death of your daughter, you probably need the master's attention as much as you ever will in your entire life. The death of an adult is one thing. The death of a child is another. We buried a little seven-year-old with my eldest brothers. And I can tell you, I'm still not over it completely. Because it was just such a horrific thing. When you've got this lively little bodies, and you've got to bury them. So second, well, first of all, they were giving him the message, you don't need Jesus. She's dead, you don't need him. That's pretty bad. As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. Jesus had already given his word, he'd go healer, didn't he? And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult. And them that wept and wailed greatly. Comes upon this, they're all out there just crying and mourning and carrying on like we would if a little girl died. Except they are really, they're into a tumult. That they're actually becoming, they're over the top. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but asleep. Now, Jesus Christ is present, and he is saying, she is asleep. Now, what is going to be the reaction of the people in the room? If you're in the room with Jesus, and he says, she's not dead, shouldn't you be going, oh, Jesus, are you going to touch her? Oh, everybody, be quiet. Let's see what Jesus is going to do. I mean, wouldn't we be excited? And they laughed him to scorn. That's sin. Jesus said, she's asleep. And they went, ah, who do you think you are? Laughing. Don't you know a dead child when you see one? Some Savior you must be. To scorn. They laughed to scorn. scorn. But when he had put them all out, he had to put them out. You have a wrong spirit, you're in here for the wrong reason, and in order for me to work, you need to be out. He taketh the father and the mother of the damsel and them that were with him, and he entered in where the damsel was lying, and he took the damsel by the hand and said to her, Talitha kumai, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years, and they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it. And I love this part. And commanded that something should be given her to eat. She's a child. She's been asleep in this coma, like say. She's awake now. Give her something to eat. But he had to put the unbelief out. Do you catch what the sin was doing in that picture? You catch what the sin was doing? The sin was arguing against Christ, right? The sin was saying, he can't do this. Who's he think he is? Doesn't know a dead child when he sees mom. How's he going to help anything? When you think about that, Jesus is in the room. Think about this, church. Don't just let it go past. Think about it for a second. Jesus is in the room.
That says, I'll do what I want to do.
mother. Now, it might be a little tiny attitude. It might be said in a nice, sweet way. I had a person one time that whenever you ask them to do something, when I was the boss and this person was under me, and I would say, could you go do that? And they'd say, whatever. Might not be what I do, but whatever. Now, what was that saying to me? They were saying to me, you might have the title of boss, but I can thumb my nose at you right in your face. And what are you going to do about it? It's that kind of attitude. You hear it? You hear that attitude? Let me let you hear it in more than one place. I want you to hear it from the Word of God. In John, the 51st chapter, and I won't go there and read it to you again. But you remember when some of the people came to Jesus, and they said, what do we do to do the works of God? And Jesus said, the work really is this simple. To believe in me, who he sent. The work is to believe in me. If you believe in me that I'm Jesus, I'm the Son of God. And they said, well, just, you know, do you have a sign you can give us? Moses gave them bread as a sign. And Jesus said, I am the bread. I am the bread. I am the bread. I am, if you eat of me, you will never hunger. If you drink of my blood, you'll never thirst. And some of them said, well, that's a hard saying. And he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. I will give my flesh to you. It will be my bread. I will give my body and my blood to you. It will be my drink. And I will give that to you. And then when you take of my body and you take of my blood, then I will be in you and you will be in me. And some of them said, that's a hard thing. Who can hear this? And some of them turned around and never walked again with him. Never again walked with Jesus. Now that's one of those people you meet out there that you say, won't you come to church with? I have a church. I've done on my own preach and to eat the body of Jesus. Well, I don't hear no such rubbish as that. God tell me to come to a service where they're going to eat bread and drink blood. I don't know where she got that. You know, that woman's crazy. Say she got out of the Bible, she's crazy. Can't believe things she says. I ain't going down there. Well, what's your general church question? Well, I heard that preacher one time. They got a reason for everything. Sin is an attitude against God. Sin is an attitude that says, I run me. And I run me the way I want to run me. And if that Bible tells me something opposite of that, I got a remedy for that. Now, I run me. And I decide what I do and what I don't. And I decide what's right and what's wrong. You say, but what are you going to do about going to heaven?
Well, Roger Irvin goes to heaven, I'll go.
Heard that one, right? I ask you, how are you going to get to heaven if you don't have a relationship with Jesus?
Well, I'm just telling you, that Carol Roy goes, I'm going.
What's that got to do with you? They have to go through the judgment on their own.
Amen.
What about you? Do you know Jesus?
No, but I doubt anybody else knows him very well either.
Sin is an attitude. Sin is a way of thinking. It's stinking thinking. And I know after the law. But I want you to get that wherever you go in this Bible, you will find it. Start looking for it. Do you remember Simon the sorcerer? And he said he got saved there in Samaria when a whole bunch of other people got saved. And then they sent some of the disciples down and they were praying. They were being filled with the Holy Spirit and everybody was being happy. And he said, now I'm a sorcerer. He had been a sorcerer. People loved for him to do bewitching and sorcery things for them. And now all of a sudden, being a Christian has upstaged him. So he said, I want to buy. Here, I got some money. I want to give you this money, and you give me the power to pray over people and they get filled with the Holy Spirit. Peter said, you have no lot, no part in the kingdom of Christ. Your heart's not right. Your heart's not right. He thought he could buy the kingdom. Sin is an attitude that is against Christ. It's when the Lord says to you, I want you to stop doing A, B, and C. And I want to stop for the rest of your days. Done. And you go, well, I might get C, B, maybe a couple of years, but A is going to the grave with me. What about when the Lord says, I want you to begin doing A, B, and C? Well, that reading the Bible every day, I mean, I'm not going to preach. He didn't call me to preach, so why should I read the Bible every day? If I go to church, that's her job. We pay her to read the Bible and tell me what it says. Well, how about your tithe? Give work all I do to get that money, and then give 10% of it to what? Pay that preacher? We pay that preacher. 10%. Who come up with that idea? Now, where do they get 10%? Is that in the Bible? You show it to me in the Bible. It's right here. Well, that don't say 10% of my money. It says 10% of cumin and spices. Because that's what they raised back then. 10% of their crop. We don't say 10% of my paycheck. Well, let's go over here and look at the history of it. I'm not paying that church money. What's the attitude? It says, thou shalt not steal, I'll steal if I want to. It says, I should not lie. If you know how many lies I've already told, what am I going to do about 1,000 of them on it? I've got 10 more to get them going. It says it shouldn't cheat. Well, it depends on what you call cheating. It says I should love the Lord with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. Now, how are you going to do that? Who loves the Lord that much? Love my neighbor as myself? Now, how can I love you like I love me? Sin. Sin is an attitude. But you that says whatever God says, whatever the Bible says, I'm telling you, I'm running my life different. And that's that. I've sat and heard people tell the stories and tell the tales, and I've heard them. I heard them argue against this book. I heard them fight against this book. And then, and I'll try to close with this. And then, I've been in the services where the Lord just sweetly showed up through the words of a song, through the raised hand of somebody that's blessed. I've gone in at my Aunt Ori's and her say, Wilma, have you got about a half hour just to sit down? I do if you need me, Aunt Ori, what is it? Well, I read a scripture the other day and I don't know what it means. I don't know if I will, but we can read it together. Why don't you read it and explain it to me and I'll fix you some tomato duck. Well, Aunt Lori, I can stay an Aunt Lori. I've gone in at older people's homes and younger people's homes that had this Bible open to a certain place and say, you know, I read down this verse today. You know, that I'm going through this trial or that trial, but you know, I found this verse. And this verse just spoke to my heart and made me such peace. And I did at the side of the beds when they said, Pastor, will you just pray one more prayer? Just pray one more prayer. I'm pretty sure my life is over, but just take my hands and pray. That makes me think of a great big giant elder that I had one time. Giant to me, I guess it got my name. To me, giant elder. He was never married, but he was married, but he never had children. An older man. And he was just a sweet old man that everybody had just taken as their own in the church over the years because he had no man. And he had given me like $2,000. And he said, now, Pastor, I want you to take this $2,000 and I want you to put it up at home. And then when I get to, I'm in a nursing home or something, I want you to come by there at least every other day. They'll be close to your work. I want you just to come by and see if I need anything. And then you'll have that money and go get it. And I said, well, okay, we'll do it. And I took the money home and put it up, and sure enough, within a year or so, he was in the nursing home. And as the time went by, he asked me for buttermilk, or I would have gotten it on my own, but he was taking care of it. Maybe another pair of pajamas or whatever. And it's kind of like having an elder, but then he's kind of like a father or a grandfather. And one day I went there, and he said, his hand was about that long, and I put mine in it, it looked like a little kid's hand in it. And he reached that big hand out, and he said, can you help me set up? I said, I can try. And I helped him set up, and get one of his legs on the side of the bed, and helped him get all fixed. And he said, now the reason I wanted to do that, he said, I think this will be our last day together. And I wanted to sit up like a man and have courage. He said, now you pull a chair over here, and I pulled the chair over facing him, and we took hands, and we had prayer. And that was our goodbye. I had a mentor minister, one of the greatest men on the face of the earth, and his wife had passed, and he was getting sicker all the time, and I would go to see him about an hour from my home. And one day he called and he said, now don't come today. That takes 2 hours of your time. And I figured out, if you just call me, if you got a cup of coffee, and I got a cup of coffee, and we called each other, we can talk all night. Because you won't have all that driving time. So we talked, and he advised me at the church that I was at, and gave me all kinds of final advice. And when we hung up that day, we said we loved each other, thanked each other. And within a day or two, they called and said he just laid back on his bed and he's gone. When you really just obey this book, there's such wealth in it.
Amen.
There's such wealth inside you. There's wealth of knowing the Lord. There's the wealth of being with the Lord totally. There's the wealth of knowing people. He said, I will add to you, if you've ever left anything for me, I'll add to you 100. Don't give you 100 mothers. Well, I probably had 1,000. Moving from church to church. He said, I'll add to you brothers and sisters. I'll add to you. I'll add to your life. I will do for you. I'll be there in times of trouble. The reason the devil wants people to fight so against God is because he knows if they ever get solidly with Jesus Christ, he's lost them forever. Because once you've truly been 100% submitted to Jesus Christ, you'll never want another master. You'll never want anything else.
Amen.
It's just that rich. It's just that full. Actually, sing the good song. As we enter into a time of praying for sinners, my study has shown me that we are going to have to think about how is that person fighting against the will of God. You know, if I say to you, I don't have time to go to church, I'm going against this Bible when I say that, because he gave me 52 Sundays to go to church. So when I tell you I don't have 52 Sundays, I'm going against this book. When I tell you I don't have time to read the Bible, put a little check on your phone and see how many hours a day you're on your phone. You might find 15 minutes to read the Bible. That's the answer. Submitting to Christ is wonderful. But if we start praying for sinners, we have to understand they are resisting submitting to one another for sinners. That's what keeps them in sin. The attitude of the mind. As we sin, you want to pray about anything.
I'm
whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believeth on him is not condemned, but he who believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. All hearts clear before we dismiss.
This all about our good news. Thank the Lord for this word that we've heard today, that we need to take just with us daily as we go about our life each day. Father, Lord, we come to you, thanking you, asking you, God, to go with us down through this day. Be with us, Lord, as we try our best to serve you, Father. We ask that you bless, be with us, give us safety, Father, Lord. Bring us back tonight, Father, Lord, to your house, we pray. Amen.